So what could other river and watershed groups working on similar issues, maybe smaller scale than the Mississippi and the Gulf Dead Zone, but similar issues, learn from the work that you all have done and others have done to address the Dead Zone? What should they take away?
Well, having worked on the Dead Zone as an organization for over 15 years, we've tried several different things to address the Dead Zone, and some with success and some with just building bureaucracies that don't really get us anywhere. And so I think some of the lessons learned that we could, you know, share, that I could share, are one is really involving the people upstream. Us being involved in the Mississippi River Collaborative has really been helpful in conveying the message of the Dead Zone to the upper basin, because, you know, the ideal is to address the pollution before it goes into the water, and most of the pollution doesn't go in at the Gulf, it goes in upstream. So, you know, really involving you know, people that can make a difference to where to stop the pollution from getting in the first place. Mm-hmm. I think another suggestion that I would say is you know, making sure to develop relationships with technical experts, relationships with scientists that are studying the phenomenon in your watershed, because a lot of times Dead Zones, unless you have a massive event like a fish kill or a harmful algae bloom or something like that, you know, people aren't really paying attention to this, and they hear the word nutrients and they think, oh, that's, you know, that's what's in my breakfast cereal, how can that be bad? And so it's so another lesson that we've really learned is learning how to communicate these issues so they're more understandable. You know, I, as a policy person, often get bogged down in talking about very policy-oriented things and using acronyms and using the word nutrients and things like that, calling the Dead Zone the hypoxic zone, mm-hmm. and all that kind of stuff. And I think when you're talking to experts, you know, you need to use that terminology, you need to know it, but really communicating the issues and how things impact people and how pollution impacts people on a personal level is really, really important when you're trying to address some of these issues that you can't just point at and say, look, there's a problem, right. You know, the Cuyahoga is not on fire, you know. And so it's, I think, really making sure that you are using the right terminology to express the problem and to try and get people invested in a solution.